Okay, I got something fun for you. Yeah, you knew I was gonna talk about silphium, didn't you? Maybe you didn't. Maybe you had no idea. But anyway, we're talking about silphiums again today. This time it's silphium lacionatum. Lacionatum means cut leaf, basically. So you see those leaves? They're highly divided. It's lacionatum. Anyway, we also got this extremely pilose stem. Very, very pubescent stem. You know, and that's not just a means of negating the effects of drought, because those hairs help keep water from evaporating from the plant. And silphiums, of course, they're drought specialists. So if you're in a Great Plain plant, you better have something to protect you from droughts. But it also kind of protects from insect invasions, which, of course, plenty of insects, like whoever made these little scars on here, plenty of insects, look at that, find ways to evolve to get around that shit, and they dig themselves into these stems where they lay their babies. And in the holes that they leave behind is this extremely thick resin. These plants are called all kinds of things after this resin, including rosin weed. Because this stuff is incredibly sticky. Supposedly Native Americans used to chew on it. I think that's some white people bullshit, because you put that in your mouth and it's never getting out. What's also cool is that these flowers, as with most silphiums, they are composite flowers, meaning that they have like these composite flowers right here, these Rudbeckia hirtas. It might not be Rudbeckia hirta, but it's something in Rudbeckia. They got the ray florets, which are look like petals, but they're actually florets of their own. And then you got the disc florets, which are the ones that are in the middle here, and they haven't quite opened yet. So you still have both of those with silphium, but the thing is that only the ray florets, the ones that are the petals, form seed. So when it's time to go to seed, all the seeds that are viable are just, they're on the very outside of the bract right here. And the bract, of course, is this part which holds it all together. I believe, as with most Asteraceae, this kind of bract is called an involucre, because it's basically cup-shaped. So only the viable seeds are only on the outside. You see, though, you still got disc florets, though. There's still disc florets. It's just, they're really only there to receive pollen or distribute pollen. I'm always really bad at telling. I actually think that these guys might be distributing pollen rather than receptive to pollen. And then the ones on the edges that are underneath the petals are receptive to pollen. So those would be your female parts, and those are your male parts in the middle here. Anyway, these silphium plants, if you didn't get that idea from all the insects and whatnot that have figured their way into the stems all winter long, where they can basically, their eggs can hibernate and then hatch in spring when their stems are dry. If you didn't figure it out already, these silphium plants tend to create their own little micro ecosystems. So if you got a silphium plant that, and you're measuring like a square meter area, that biodiversity index, as far as plants goes, is severely reduced in a tall grass prairie. But if we're talking about not just plants, then it's probably not all that much reduced, because these things have, you know, a root complex that probably stretches out to here. Who's to say? It could be wider. And it goes down upwards of 15 feet in mature plants. And these plants can be very mature. They can live a very long time. You can pave over this shit, and if you remove the pavement, the root might still be alive and send up a stem. But yeah, they have their own microcosmos living amidst these roots, creating the famous prairie soil. Here's an example, a little tiny example of the microcosmos in this plant's, you know, domain. It's a little crab spider. I'm not good with arachnids. I don't know the scientific name of this guy, so you'll have to forgive me for not being that much of a nerd. I would like to be more of a nerd. I wasn't saying that derogatorily. I'm not that much of a nerd yet. But I know that's a crab spider, because it's got the little crabby legs. And what they do, like this guy has already done, or this female most likely has already done, is they wait for pollinators to come around. They tend to pick flowers that they camouflage with. They wait for a pollinator to come around and they snatch it. And that's it. And one more cool thing about silphium. It's fucking awesome. I love this. I love this so much. Look at where they're all pointing. You see how they're all pointing one way? They're not pointing at the sun, though. That's west, okay? That's the sun, so that's west. If you don't know that, go to school.
And these guys are not pointing west. They're pointing about 40 degrees south of west, which is exactly what they're supposed to do. The flowers, they try to, again, they try. They're not always perfect. Like this little deviant bastard right there who's gonna, who's just, you know, doing some sun staring, trying to get enlightened and shit. And then these guys are gonna stare about 40 degrees south of west. And the whole point of this, and even the leaves, look, the leaves, they attempt to kind of orient themselves that way. And the point of this is because it seems to be kind of the golden area. It seems to be the golden balance between sun exposure for photosynthesis and, you know, being too much sun exposure for transpirative evaporation. So by pointing themselves 40 degrees south of west, they avoid a little more of that evaporation along with the pillow stems, and they still get a pretty brunt attack of sunlight at all times, constantly getting a good dose of sunlight, so that they can photosynthesize enough to make all this shit. They're big-ass plants, aren't they? All right. All right, I hope you like my Silphium rant.